Kia ora, I'm Esme.
And I'm Mackenzie.
And this is your level one chance and data strategy video.
So chance and data includes having to use some analytical and some critical thinking skills and applying them to real world scenarios. And so the key topics included in this standard is calculating probabilities and analyzing data.
Here are some key tips to help you to succeed. Okay, so one of the first things you need to do is notice all of the key features on a graph. The first one is the mean. The mean is just all of the numbers added together and then divided by the number of numbers that there are. Next, you need to look at the mode, which is just your most common number, and your median, which is the number that falls right in the middle. Now, the median is the best form of the mean. This is because it doesn't get affected by crazy outliers on the top or the bottom. Because of this, you may get asked questions in your exam that ask you what the best time of mean is. Your answer here is always the median. The next thing you need to be able to do is understand and interpret box and whisker graphs. This means looking at the interquartile range, which is your middle 50%, your upper quartile, which is your top 25% of values, and your lower quartile, which is your bottom 25%. Once you've done this, you can go ahead and start to answer your questions. A really good trick is to take a pen into your exam and circle everything on the graph that you may need to write about later on.
Cool, so another strategy for success is to concentrate on the key words. And basically what these are the concepts that you've learned to help you analyze the graphs that you've been given. So these include things like the average, the mean spread, things like outliers, the general trend, whether it be positive or negative. There are heaps of other things that you're able to discuss. So the more of these you include in your analysis, the better. If you have a bit of extra time at the end of your exam, it can pay to go back and see if you can add any more in your discussion. Now, another thing is to analyze the trends on your graphs, which is essentially the biggest thing that you really want to be discussing. And if you haven't been given one already, it can be really useful to add in a trend line. This is also sometimes called a regression or the gradient line. Whatever it is that you've learned, they all mean the same thing. It just tells you the general movement of your data. And included in this, you might be able to see other things such as subtrends, where at different points of your graph, your data might be tending towards a slightly different direction. Now, in your analysis of each of the trends, you really want to be using some specific data points in your discussion. So if, for example, you had a positive trend, you would discuss one of the earlier data points where it was lower and then a later data point where it was higher, so you can really show this comparison.
So you're likely to come across questions where you need to compare two data sets and draw a conclusion. For example, you may get asked, are girls or boys more likely to perform better in a maths exam? You'll need to compare key features of both data sets in order to draw your conclusion. Make sure for these questions you focus on both similarities and on differences. Another question you'll get is ones where it asks you to draw from and talk about specific contexts. For example, you may get data that tells you that New Zealanders have been more and more likely to go on holiday in Australia. From this context, you may get asked to make new conclusions. For example, if the trend has been going up steadily each year, you could say that it's likely to increase again the next year. The important thing with these questions is to avoid saying things like there will definitely be or there will be a further increase. You want to make sure that you say things like it is likely or there probably will be. This shows that you know that even though there's a strong trend, it doesn't mean that things will necessarily 100% occur.
Now, for excellence, one of the biggest things that you really should be considering is the limits of your statistical investigation. Now, what this includes is analysing the different components of the actual study itself. So these could include things like generalizability. So the sample that you've taken, can your results actually be applied to the wider population or is it skewed? If you take something like a sample of Year 11 students from one individual school, would you be able to generalize that to the entire population? Probably not. So it's important to discuss these kind of things. Another thing to consider is something like the trend line. We can't make predictions about a trend outside of the given data sample that we have. It's just not good science. So instead of doing things like this, if we are trying to make predictions, we have to keep it within the realm of the graph or point out exactly why it's not appropriate to try and make any predictions based off this data that comes outside of our minimum or our maximum. We also want to be considering how our result links to the sample and how it answers our question. And it's also really useful to point out ways that we can overcome the limitations that we have identified. So for example, if our sample wasn't generalizable, we should be taking a bigger sample. Maybe if we wanted all Year 11 students, we should take a few different schools over New Zealand. Rural versus cities, the results might be a bit different.
So it's really important that you make sure to pay attention to the wording of the questions. If you get told that event A or event B could happen, make sure to work out each probability separately and then add them together. But if you get told that event A and event B must happen, work out each probability and then multiply them together. If you get given a question with multiple steps have to happen, draw a tree diagram to help you work it out. Over here is a tree diagram with 2 red balls and 5 blue balls, where we're drawing one out without replacement.
Understanding the important features of tree diagrams is key in understanding how to actually interpret them. So you should bear in mind that events or selections are the first layers of the tree and they go in your rows. And if you're trying to calculate one probability, we multiply down our trees. Now, if we're wanting to add some multiple probabilities together, we calculate the probabilities individually and then add them together right at the end. Also, bear in mind that your questions may include things like the ball wasn't replaced or the jelly bean wasn't replaced or whatever obscure object is being pulled out of a bag. So, in conditional probability, remember that if it wasn't replaced after the first time, that your next probabilities are going to change because the amount of objects in that bag has also changed.
So your success in this standard is largely based on your ability to take data and relate it back to a specific context. Remember that not only are you answering questions, but you're also giving context as to how well you're able to answer them and how your answer or certainty could be improved if you had more information.
Cool, so we've covered a lot, but we haven't covered absolutely everything. We recommend that you guys check out 2 to 3 years worth of past exam papers so you get a feel for what the exam is going to be like. And also check out our StudyTime walkthrough guides. So they're available for free online, or you can buy them in print with next day delivery. And they're designed to walk you through the entirety of the standard and anything that could be involved in it. So good luck, guys.